Welcome back, everybody. This week, we're going to be talking about logic. If you recall from last time, I explained that logic is the field of philosophy that studies correct reasoning. What is an argument? What makes an argument a good argument? How do we evaluate arguments? It is also the tools of the philosopher. Biologists have microscopes and slides, and chemists have Bunsen burners and beakers. Every field of study has its own set of tools that it uses. Well, philosophy, our tool is logic. Okay, we don't get the fancy machines, we get logic. So, when we talk about logic, when we talk about arguments, we're not talking about that version or that use of argument that we are accustomed to in our everyday lives. In philosophy, argument means something very specific. It means a set of sentences with premises and conclusion. Okay, a set of sentences with premises and conclusion. So anytime I use argument in my lectures, in my class, to be perfectly honest, I would expect most of the time when I use it in the world, I mean it as exactly this, a set of sentences that have premises and conclusion. What this means is an argument cannot be one sentence. It cannot be a question. I know in everyday language, the way people use the word argument sometimes means a question like, what is abortion? But that's not an argument. That's an issue. That's a topic of discussion, perhaps a topic of debate. When one person presents something and then another person presents the opposing view, that's not an argument, that's a debate. An argument is, in philosophy, and for the next who knows how many weeks, I want you to get used to this, okay? You need to understand that anytime you use this word in this class, anytime I use this word, I mean it to be a set of sentences, okay? Set of sentences with premises and conclusion, meaning at least two sentences. If you want any chance at it being a good argument, you're going to need three, but at least two sentences. Now, premises, this is a word that you may not be super familiar with. Premises are the reasons for the conclusion, okay? These are the things that offer up support for the conclusion. And when you're reading in your book, you're going to be looking for certain indicator words. These indicator words are because, for, if, follows from. These are indicator words that something is a premise. If you read, consider this. You read the sentence, Max is a bad man because he beats his wife. Okay? Max is a bad man because he beats his wife. This is a complex sentence, okay? It is just, it's two sentences, even though grammatically we've joined them with the word because. And the word because there is a premise word. Premise, he beats his wife. Conclusion, therefore he's a bad man. Okay? So that's what you want to look for. The fact that Max is a bad man follows from the fact that he beats his wife. Okay? So these are indicator words for premises. Now, the conclusion you should not be as unfamiliar with, right? A conclusion is the end result, what is being argued for, okay? This is where we're trying to get. The premises support the end result, the conclusion. And as you're reading, you're going to look for indicator words, therefore, hence, thus, so. Consider this. Max beats his wife, so he is a bad man. So is our indicator word there, right? Now, the premise, Max beats his wife, has come first in our complex sentence, but that is the premise. So he's a bad man. Bad man, he is a bad man, is our conclusion. Okay? So as you're reading in future weeks, you are going to want to be looking for that, because our Socratic method, our dialogue that we saw last time, that is going to be more clear if you recognize these indicator words. Okay? That, remember our Socratic method, somebody offers a question and somebody gives an answer. Well, that's going to be our therefores. And when they explain their answers, they're going to be using, you know, our premise indicator words. So that's the structure of the argument. Those are the bare bones of the argument, and that's where we start.